You take this common raw material, limestone, grind it down, mix it with some rocks, heat it up to the temperature of molten lava, then let it cool, grind it again, and what do you have? Well, that's the basic recipe for cement. Sounds relatively simple, right? But there is a major complication. The cement industry is a massive CO2 emitter. The business wants to go carbon neutral, so is that even possible? Roads and highways are made with cement. High-rise skyscrapers, cement. The building where you're watching this video right now, somewhere there's cement. The cement industry has quietly doubled its emissions in the last 20 years. The main reason? The amount of this material needed in both industrialized and developing countries.
Sí, hoy día tenemos ese nivel de emisión, no porque seamos tan intensivos en la emisión del producto, sino fundamentalmente porque es el producto que más se utiliza a nivel mundial después del agua.
The cement industry is one of the world's most carbon intensive. If it were a country, it would be the third largest carbon dioxide emitter on the planet. And its use has exploded in recent decades, led by far by China. That country so outpaces the rest of the world's cement consumption that in 2020 it used nearly 10 times as much cement as its closest competitor, India, around 2.4 billion tons compared to 290 million. And use is expected to continue to grow globally, worth nearly $327 billion in 2021. Cement production is anticipated to increase dramatically before the end of this decade. Just outside of the German capital, Berlin, Mexican cement giant Cemex is trialing new solutions to combat some of the problems plaguing the industry. It's one of several flagship factories around the world where Cemex is trying to tackle the massive problems. This one in the European Union. After growth of the industry comes heat. Back to our recipe from the beginning. Limestone and these other rocks we mentioned need to be heated to the temperature of molten lava. That's not an exaggeration. Huge ovens known as kilns like this one need to reach temperatures of over 1400 degrees Celsius. We're standing dozens of meters above the Cemex kiln, and you can still feel the heat and see the air shimmer.
We don't need to have that temperature just for a couple of minutes or an hour. We need to have that temperature 24/7. Whole day long, whole week long.
Keeping a kiln at this temperature, it's one big energy suck, and it's mostly being powered by fossil fuels. Think coal, oil, and natural gas. And a massive part of the industry's emissions come from the energy to run a cement factory, which includes the kiln. Now, you might be wondering, why not just use solar panels like these or other renewables to heat that kiln that needs so much energy? Well, simply put, renewable energy can't generate the kinds of heat needed, especially not on an industrial scale. That's how Robbie Andrew, a senior researcher at the Cicero Center for International Climate Research, explained it. He's been following how industry emits CO2.
Traditionally, they kind of topped out around 100 degrees or something like that. So there are new developments there, getting them up to 400 or 500, which is kind of, you know, the middle range for industrial heat usage. But in cement manufacture, we're talking about over 1400 degrees Celsius. So it's really high temperatures.
Rather than relying just on fossil fuels, Cemex has been increasing its mix of so-called alternative fuels. In 2022, these fuels made up approximately 35% of the energy mix used to heat that kiln. We're talking burning waste plastics that would otherwise have ended up in landfills, dried sludge from sewage and industrial management plants. Yes, that can mean human waste. And biomass, essentially shredded wood that is, at least on paper, made carbon neutral by the planting of replacement trees. Right now, there are test projects under development that could let renewables play a larger part in cement production, like this concentrated solar energy field, which uses massive mirrors to really focus the sun's rays and could one day be used to heat kilns to those super high temperatures. But it's fair to say that they're not quite there yet, and until the technology is ready to use, it could take some time. Of course, the whole reason that companies need so much energy to create so much heat is because of this guy, limestone. chemically known as calcium carbonate, when heated, a limestone molecule separates, leaving behind calcium oxide, or CaO, which is a great binding agent in cement, but also left behind carbon dioxide, not so useful and a big contributor to global warming. In fact, at least half of CO2 from cement manufacturing comes from this so-called calcination process.
That is fundamental because it means that you can't simply move away from fossil fuels.
Joanna Lina works for the climate change think tank E3G, where she leads the industry transition and trade program.
You can't simply use a more energy efficient kiln. You need to actually either fundamentally change the kind of chemistry of how you're producing cement, move towards different raw materials, or you need to capture that carbon and store it.
Reducing the amount of this limestone mixture in a cement recipe has been a decades-long goal of the cement industry. Not only does less of the mixture, also known as clinker, mean less energy to cook that rocky mixture, but it also means less leftover CO2. New recipes for greener cement fall into two main categories: recycled materials and ingredient replacement. By recycling materials, there's two theoretical benefits: a circular economy and less energy used, because you don't have to cook that virgin limestone again. So, what kind of materials could be recycled? In some cases, old concrete from demolished buildings can be ground up and replace a certain percentage of the essential ingredients that we mentioned at the beginning to make cement. Hissam Azari Jafari works for the Concrete Sustainability Hub at MIT and says there's a lot of hesitation about this technique.
It can be used and replace the virgin aggregates that we are using for concrete construction. There's a lot of precautions with use of this kind of recycled materials to make sure that it doesn't compromise the performance of the concrete mixture as well.
What type of concrete, and so cement, is needed is dictated by how much pressure or weight it has to hold or how durable to the elements it has to be. Think of a load-bearing pillar versus a road, different functions and different exposures to the elements. So you need to make sure the recipe you're using makes a cement that is up to the job. Using recycled materials prevents emissions from machinery that would otherwise be used to mine for new resources. But carbon dioxide is still emitted when knocking down and transporting old building pieces.
We have to classify it, we have to crush it, sort it again, and then transport it again to the next concrete production facility.
That's especially true if buildings aren't properly labeled with the materials that they're made of. So sorting the debris has the potential to be more carbon intensive than digging fresh materials out of the ground. So what about the other option? What could limestone be replaced with? There are a few materials being considered to replace limestone, at least in part. One is iron slag, the other is calcium silicate.
Whereas limestone has carbon and oxygen in it, which you try to strip out to get your calcium oxide, the calcium silicate doesn't have the carbon in it. So that when you break it down to get the calcium that you want, you don't release CO2.
The recipes are still under development on how exactly calcium silicate or other rocks can replace limestone. Testing is still needed to make sure that a recipe made with any substitute will stand the test of time. Customers want assurances that buildings will stay standing and age well. The truth is that even if the strategies we've already mentioned work, producing cement will still emit a lot of CO2. And so the industry has another solution, and a controversial one: carbon capture and storage, or CCS. This essentially means that right when a carbon dioxide molecule would be released from the source, it's chemically captured, meaning it's not released into the atmosphere. Proponents say CCS is essential if cement is to make a significant dent in its emissions. CEMEX plans to capture the majority of its emissions at the facility near Berlin through CCS by 2030.
I wouldn't say easy. It's expensive and complicated, but it's doable. It's a proven technology.
The technology is decades old, but it has yet to be used at scale. Countries like Germany have strict storage regulations, even as projects like this one here in Norway are hoping to soon accept CO2 from industrial sites. But critics argue cement business plans that include carbon capture and storage don't make economic sense. They say that the plans that include CCS would dramatically increase the price. And it could simply allow high carbon industries to keep on emitting. Big shifts within the construction industry are on the horizon. The European Union, for example, is discussing stricter carbon emission standards from the industry. And while some customers want the green shine that comes with lower carbon cement, many still want the cheapest and most reliable options. So, can cement be made with fewer emissions? Yes, it's already happening, to some extent. But technology needs to accelerate, and companies need to be investing in that technology to help get them there. This is especially true in regions that are expected to rapidly develop in the coming decades. And as these countries continue to build roads, hospitals, and other infrastructure, there are options. Carbon capture could help solve the process emissions problem that comes with limestone, but the technology and regulatory frameworks aren't in place yet. Improving green energy technology is a possibility for replacing the massive amounts of energy needed to heat kilns and other parts of the manufacturing process. And of course, recycling materials and building things to last are also critical to long-term carbon savings.
This new recognition that we need to reduce global emissions to net zero by 2050 is a real spur to drive that further. But it's hard for this industry. The global industry has a roadmap for reducing emissions. They're very clear that that requires all sorts of changes to the market, the recognition of value. It requires all sorts of government interventions, and it requires technology development.
Do you think the cement industry will stay true to these promises and goals? Tell us in the comments below. And if you're looking for more business solutions to the climate crisis, check out the Transforming Business playlist.